Welcome to Beijing. Here we are. After arriving at the hostel, we already placed our bags in our room, had a very nice meal in a simple restaurant nearby, and we met this Brazilian guy. Very cool guy. Now we are heading to the Summer Palace. And what can you tell us about the metro, huh? The subway?
Yeah, the subway.
The subway, it was actually pretty good because we weren't expecting that everything was in our alphabet. Everything was in English.
Everything is in both alphabets?
Yes.
Yeah. There is lots and lots of people everywhere. You have to get in a line to get tickets for basically everything. But the metro, the subway system is really good. It is so...
Very organized.
So hot in here.
Yeah, the heat. So with the humidity.
The moisture, right?
Yeah. You cannot breathe the lack of oxygen. You have to drink lots of water.
Yeah, you have to drink a lot.
You can look at the sky. We think it's probably smog.
Yeah, the pollution, you can feel it.
It contributes, I think, to the heat.
Yeah, so to the Summer Palace we go.
The Summer Palace. Covering an area of approximately 3 square kilometers, this complex of gardens and lakes had its origins in the Jin Dynasty in the 12th century. The palace as we know it today was first built in 1750 by Emperor Qianlong and rebuilt in the Qing Dynasty after it was destroyed by enemy invasions. Although we only had a few hours to spend in this majestic place, you can easily spend half a day or more in the Summer Palace. Stories tell that former emperors used to pretend they were shopping with their concubines in this place. They pretended, of course, because everything in the palace was already theirs to begin with. It is said that the Summer Palace is the best preserved imperial garden in the world and the largest in China. It has been a UNESCO World Heritage Site since 1998. The entry fee costs 30 yuan, and the palace can be reached going by subway to the Baigongmen station.
Hello!
Hi! So, here we are, next to our hostel, eating the true Beijing roast duck.
Yes!
Which is the most famous dish here in Beijing. What do we have here? We have the duck skin, which is very tasty. And these two parts of the duck, of duck meat. You dive them in here.
Yes.
And then with these, which is like a bread, pasta, you mix them like this. And then you can season it a bit with the onions and all this. Then you roll them. Just like back home. Then you go for it.
All right. Is
very
it good?
Nice. Very nice.
Is it good?
Very exquisite.
Yes. How about the beer? Do you like it?
Yes, it's good.
Beer, yeah.
Really exquisite.
Good morning. We are going to the wall. The wall of China.
Finally.
Yeah, finally.
So what was our breakfast?
It was great. Really.
Our breakfast
really
was
really traditional. Really. It was McDonald's.
It was a hamburger at McDonald's.
It wasn't us that chose that meal. Our tour included that. It's a little bit strange, but
it's yeah. For 4 hours or something.
Well, we are going to the wall, and we are going to part of the wall which was not rebuilt. And
best preserved part of the wall.
Yes.
Not the most touristic. Curiously, probably because it's further away. It's 3.5 hours ride. From Beijing.
Yes, it's very far.
So it's very far away. And but it's really well preserved, and we are in great expectations.
Yeah.
It will be nice, surely.
Let's go.
We got a 260 yuan one-day tour.
60.
Which doesn't include the ticket, but we pay for the ticket in the bus. Which is 65 yuan. What, like 8 euros, something
yeah,
like that?
Something like that.
And
alright, so we'll try to sleep on the bus.
Yeah.
And okay, let's go.
Yeah,
okay, let's go.
Yeah, good luck.
We were on our way to the Jinshanling section of what we were expecting to be the greatest landmark so far in this journey, the Great Wall of China. Located 80 miles to the northeast of Beijing, this section of the wall is way less visited than other sections, like Badaling and Shuiguan. Although not as well restored as, for example, Badaling, Jinshanling had its original structure better preserved than most of the other sections. It is for these reasons, distance and state of restoration, that this section is considerably less visited by tourists, which is great for us. Once I climbed to the top, I was blown away with the greatness of this absolute wonder of mankind. Although the wall was originally built by the first emperor of the Qin dynasty around 2200 years ago, the Jinshanling section of the wall, as we know it today, was built by the Ming in the 16th century. It has 67 watchtowers and 3 beacon towers. It takes around 5 hours to hike all the way from the beginning of the section to Simatai, the town on the other end of the section. The best time to visit Jinshanling is between April and June.
We are in the Great Wall of China, in this segment of Jinshanling.
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 Welcome to the wall. Mongolia, China.
You can see Mongolia, up north.
So this was first built in the 1500s. This section of the wall was used to unify some of the walls that protected the ancient kingdoms of China. That's why the Great Wall was built.
The first partial walls were built in the 7th century before Christ, but the most part of the wall was built in the 14th century by the Ming dynasty. Now it extended for 4,800 kilometers from the Bo Sea
in the east.
In the east to the Gobi Desert in the west.
The Great Wall is a UNESCO World Heritage Site, and it's one of the 7 wonders of the world. It's easy to understand why.
Yes.
This is just breathtaking. It's just, it's really hard to describe this in words.
Yes, it's overwhelming. Now there's a lot of steps. You need to be with a good energy. Step, this is very hot. Let's just keep going.
Among other fascinating facts about the Great Wall of China, the length of the Ming Dynasty Great Wall is over 8,800 kilometers, and the total length of the ancient walls that were unified to originally form the Great Wall goes over 21,000 kilometers. Although over a third of it has disappeared over the course of history. The labor for its construction included soldiers, convicts, and prisoners of war. The Ming Great Wall crosses 9 Chinese provinces and is visited by more than 10 million people per year on average. The height of the wall can go from around 8 to 14 meters. The modern preservation and protection of the wall began in 1957, and it has been a UNESCO site since 1987.
So, after walking on the wall for around 1 hour, we are now resting in the place, the watchtower called the Dark Tower, because of a girl that saved the tower when the tower caught fire once, around 500 years ago. And she died to save the tower, so. So any particular feedback?
It's very, very hot.
Yeah.
There's a lot of Chinese tourists also.
Lots of ups and downs.
Yeah, it's really hard work to walk in here. It's not like walking in the park. There are steps that are this tall. There are steps this tall.
This tall.
And it takes hard work.
Yes, a lot of Chinese tourists, but this part of the wall is still very quiet, and you can take pictures and without the crowded.
It's very good for that, because you can take awesome pictures without any kind of, you know, people. We got some more.
Women sell water and other drinks. It looks like the Holy Grail, because it's so hot and you really need water. That, they know that.
That's why it's pretty goddamn expensive, because, well, 7 yuan isn't much, but comparing to, for example, Summer Palace, where we got one water for 2 yuan, so it's more than twice the price. It's cool in here. looks like a miracle. We're gonna start heading back. So, the wall.
The wall.
We are the watchers on the wall. Beijing. We arrived from the wall after 4 hours on the bus, and here we are in Wangfujing Street, very famous street here in Beijing, especially by night, where you can shop for everything. And we are heading for the place where we're gonna have dinner. We can only tell this is going to be the most how to put it, the most special food experience probably ever. So far, at least, because there, you know, there is a very famous night food market just around the corner where you can eat the most exquisite things.
Wangfujing Night Food Market. This was a night filled with bizarre memories indeed. This night market is home to over 100 food stalls that sell more than 100 different snacks and exquisite Chinese delicacies from all over China. For the most adventurous, this is a paradise where lizards, insects, centipedes and other delights are waiting to be tried out. In this food experience, we started off by eating fried seahorse, which tasted a bit like sardines, but it's more crunchy. After that, we tried out fried scorpions, which, believe it or not, are delicious. Definitely recommended. For 20 yuan, you get to eat three of these crunchy fellows. From there, we went on to try fried cicadas, which tastes like half sausage, half soybeans, half chicken. It was weird, but not bad, at least in my personal opinion. The next one was tough. Butterfly cocoons. These were hardcore. They took a long time to fry and even longer to eat. We all did it though, while Chinese tourists looked at us in disgust. Yes, not all Chinese eat insects just like that, unless you're from Canton. From there we moved on to try giant grasshoppers, and those were terrible, at least in my opinion. You never tried stuff like this and you're curious? Here's a tip for you. Try the small ones first. The market was huge and easy to get lost inside. After walking for a while, we discovered tarantulas for sale. Yes, indeed. 100 yuan for one of those, expensive, but definitely worth it. It was really, really tasty. By the time we were almost full of weird things in our stomachs, there was still room for a little crunchy lizard. Not really recommended though. It's mostly skin, it's really hard to chew, and not that tasty anyway.
So good morning.
Morning.
Morning, morning, morning. So after that magnificent dinner yesterday, we are now starting the day in a very zen way, visiting the gardens of Temple of Heaven, which we are expecting to be really mind-blowing. Ticket price is, I think, 35 yuan. Yeah, so let's do it.
The Temple of Heaven, built by Emperor Zhudi in the Ming Dynasty. In the 15th century, it was a place of worship for Chinese emperors, where they prayed for good fortune and good harvests. Emperors believed that a bad harvest would mean a fall from heaven's favor and could threaten the stability of the realm. So the emperor would vehemently pray, not only out of belief, but also out of political interest. The best time to visit the temple is in the morning, where the local people start their day doing morning exercises like Tai Chi. Several numerological connotations are embedded into the design of the temple. For example, the number 9 was considered the most powerful, so the slabs that formed the circular altar of the temple were laid out in multiples of 9. It is a UNESCO World Heritage Site and arguably the most famous temple in China.
This is the Imperial Vault of Heaven, right by the 9 Dragon Juniper, which is a tree that is over 500 years. Very famous in this park as well. This is a very big, 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 big park.
Yeah, lots of people.
Lots of old people training and chanting. It's really a happy and peaceful place.
That's the right description.
The circular moon was where the emperors of the Ming and Qing dynasties would celebrate the winter solstice. It was a place where they would worship the skies and their ancestors. That is the reason why nowadays everyone that visits this part of the temple complex goes into the center of the circle, for good fortune.
We are now crossing Tiananmen Square from the outside. I don't know about you, but I have never seen anything like this. This square is the biggest square I've ever seen, and it's completely filled with people. You have to go in a never-ending line to get in there, and given that it's almost 11 a.m., we are not taking the risk. We are going directly to the Forbidden City, which is over there. That's the gate of heavenly peace, with the picture of Mao Zedong. There is so much people here. This is insane. You can really feel it, the lack of space in here. And as you approach the Forbidden City, it gets worse. Look at that. There's like a sea of people in there. And this is the National Museum of China. This is the line. We gotta cross the street so we can then proceed to the Forbidden City. Yeah, you have to wait for a bit. And here we are crossing the gate of heavenly peace to the Forbidden City. We are inside the Forbidden City, which is completely monstrous in size. The lines are huge. Then you pay 60 yuan to get the ticket, and this is what you get.
Yes, it has nearly 900 rooms.
Yeah, and we entered from here. This is the gate we just crossed. So, for you guys to have an idea,
we are now.
It is really, really big. It is insane. So, this is the place, the heart of Beijing.
Visited by more than 14 million people annually, the Forbidden City is the largest ancient palace in the world and the single most popular tourist site in China. Yes, even more than the Great Wall. It is one of the three ancient palaces still standing in China and was the seat of Chinese imperial rule for over 500 years. 24 Chinese emperors ruled from the Forbidden City.
And here it is, the Hall of Supreme Harmony, the biggest of all the structures in the Forbidden City. This is where royal weddings took place. This is where the new emperors were enthroned. The announcements were made here. This was where the emperors would dispatch the generals to war. Everything happened in this place. The original structure was finished in around the year 1400. It was reconstructed and restored several times. The last time was around the 17th century, and it remains like this in the present day. This was called the Forbidden City because of obvious reasons. No one outside the court could be allowed in all of this. And this is nothing. We are just in one
hall.
This hall right here, just to give you guys a bit of sense of perspective. This big hall right here is this hall. It's this hall. So you can see that all of this is the Forbidden City. It is insane.
Built under the order of Emperor Chengzu of the Ming Dynasty, the Forbidden City has 980 wooden buildings which contain 9,999 rooms filled with ancient artifacts and treasures. Until 1911, no one was allowed to go inside the city without the Emperor's permission. Over 1 million laborers worked to complete this immense palace, which is twice the size of the Vatican and thrice the size of the Kremlin. Its largest structure is 30 meters tall. It is revered by the Chinese people and, of course, it's a UNESCO World Heritage Site.
This is Longzongmen, which means Gate of the Distinguished Clan. This gate was once called the Forbidden Gate. You know why?
Except for people who had to make urgent reports, no one was allowed to enter,
yeah.
Not even princes.
It was here in this gate, it was thanks to this gate, that the name Forbidden City originated, because no one was allowed to enter this gate. And as you can see, it remains a bit like this still. No entry for visitors. Okay, right next to the Forbidden Gate, this is the Palace of Earthly Tranquility, which then, passing through the Gate of Earthly Tranquility, leads to the Imperial Garden, which afterwards leads to the Hall of Imperial Peace.
The Imperial Garden of the Forbidden City was a private retreat for the imperial family. With the most typical of Chinese garden designs, the Imperial Garden contains over 20 structures, blended with the trees and flower beds in the most harmonizing way. The Hall of Imperial Peace is the most important building in the garden. In front of this hall, there is a 400-year-old pine tree which symbolizes the harmony between the Emperor and the Empress. After the garden, we headed for the Palace of Eternal Safety. Safe or not, for us it felt more like the Palace of Eternal Freshness due to the delicious air conditioning that felt unbelievably good. From there we passed through the Palace of Prolonging Happiness, arguably the most unique of the six eastern palaces of the Forbidden City. From there we headed to the Treasure Gallery, containing several invaluable relics from the Imperial Ages. The treasury is also where we found the Nine Dragon Screen, a 20-meter wall built in the Qing Dynasty. The wall has 270 pieces of glaze, which is a multiple of 9 times 5. Why is this relevant, you ask? Because in ancient China, the combination of the numbers 9 and 5 represented the supreme status of sovereignty.
This is the main hall of the treasure galleries. From there, on that side, we have the Hall of the Stone Drums, and there is the Hall of the Jewelry. All of this inside of this just one little part of the Forbidden City. And so, after the treasure galleries and passing through the Gate of Good Fortune, we are now heading back through the left side gates. So, as you can see, there's a lot of construction work taking place here. This is from the last invasion, which was yesterday, but things are getting repaired, so it's cool. The Forbidden City, everyone. I hope you enjoyed this semi-guided tour in this authentic labyrinth of never-ending temples, palaces and hallways and streets and roads, and this sea of Chinese wonder. Into the square we go. And so, finally, after going in there, the Forbidden City, and going all the way across from Eastern Exit, which is where they make us leave the city, we finally arrive in Tiananmen Square.
So, so large.
The biggest square in the world. It's where we are.
Yes, the fact of Tiananmen Square being the largest in the world is a topic of debate. When it comes to area, there are currently 5 squares that are bigger, 3 of those being also in China, by the way. But one thing that is commonly accepted is that it is indeed the largest paved square in the world. Named after the Gate of Heavenly Peace, which in Chinese means Tiananmen, the Tiananmen Square was built in the Ming Dynasty. It is here that several ceremonies are held, and it's where lies the mausoleum of Mao Zedong, the communist revolutionary that founded the People's Republic of China in 1949, after defeating the Kuomintang in the Chinese Civil War. The square is flanked by the Hall of the People and the National Museum of China. Several historic events took place in this square. One of the most well-known of those events was the stream of protests in 1989, where thousands of people called for democratic reforms in China. The protests were suppressed when the government declared martial law and the Chinese military killed several hundreds of protesters.
So Tiananmen Square, for you guys, but this is worth seeing, huh? Beijing is completely it's a completely overwhelming city. So, this is Rui Bayon reporting here from National Geographics. Here in the Temple of Heavens in Shanghai. Wait, what? Oh, it's Beijing, yeah. So we're in Beijing, Japan, filming the Temple of the Skies. So what do you think? I think this is a really nice bar. It's like a modern style, you know. People can come here to dance and really cool. You can listen to the...
It opens really early, this bar, yes.
Yeah. Yeah, and you can dance till here all day. It's until 8 a.m. and then opens again. God's coming to clean the place.
Alright.
It says
Beijing, Japan.
I know, I made a mistake. It was Beijing, Korea, of course.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah. So, this is the best spot in Korea. It's really, really good.
No, but now, serious. The gardens surrounding this with lots of people. By the morning.
No, but now, seriously. This is the best spot you can see in Korea. I mean, forget the, you know, the Pyongyang and the.
Get on with it.
At 7 a.m., the old people go there and do some exercise. It's nice.
Let's forget the Alhambra as well. The Alhambra is second best in Korea.
Alhambra in Italy?
In Portugal?
No, it's actually in France.
All right.
It's France.
But you see in Portugal, old people closed in a room. They should be doing this instead. In Japan they do this. And in China too.
Thanks.
All right, okay.